I'm Captain Matt Stout, and today on Franklin Fire, we're going to talk about technical rescue.
Thankfully, there was a neighbor there. Within a minute or two, I was like looking at her saying 911 right now.
Hello, I am Rob Thomas with the Franklin Fire Department, and today on Franklin Fire, we're going to be discussing Technical Rescue 5 and the tools and capabilities that it gives the fire department in aiding the citizens of this town and people of neighboring communities that may be in need.
I'm a member of the technical rescue team and recently responded to two complex mutual aid incidents. The first one was a call in Chapel Hill where a young boy got his hand stuck in a suction line in a commercial pool in a neighborhood.
It was very fast. I mean, within less than 30 seconds, I knew what was going on and was trying to get him out. Thankfully, there was a neighbor there and she was taking my baby for me so I could figure out if I could get him out. But within a minute or two, I was like looking at her saying 911 right now.
Multiple agencies in just for manpower, water as well, because a five-year-old in that kind of situation is just so chaotic because everybody else, we all have kids and we all know the situation. We know mom and dad were terrified, so we knew we had to do something in a matter of time.
It required the Technical Rescue 5 to respond due to the equipment that it carries and the nature of the entrapment. We use several tools involving concrete breaking and breaching to gain access to the pipe and ended up cutting the pipe off with a Dremel off of his hand. And he was trapped for approximately 3 hours.
It was hard work and they stuck through it and we're so glad that they did.
Physically, he's good, he's fine, he's healed up. We're putting cream on his hand for the burn, but other than that, he's good to go.
Another incident we responded to was in Murray County, where we responded to assist with a concrete truck that had rolled over on its side and pinned the driver with a large tree. Rescue 5 was called again for its equipment and additional manpower. Several other agencies helped with that as well. We used a heavy wrecker to stabilize and lift the vehicle a little bit so we could gain more access to move some more metal around the driver. And Rescue 5 struts were used to help stabilize the vehicle with struts and heavy chains. That driver was pinned for, I believe, about 2.5 hours as well. But I believe he's doing well at this time. And now Firefighter Rob Thomas is going to give you a tour of Technical Rescue 5 and its equipment.
Hello all, my name is Rob Thomas. I am with the Franklin Fire Department Station 1 A Shift. Here today to talk to you and show you a few things about one of our newer apparatus in the city. It is a technical rescue truck that would be assigned to calls involving structural collapse, having to stabilize or shore heavy pieces of equipment or buildings as they may need it. This particular vehicle is just an as-call truck. It is not a daily running truck. It's staffed as needed. There is staffing with it 24 hours a day, so if it is needed, it can be dispatched out at any minute of any day. It is primarily, again, used in heavy lifting and moving, stabilization of materials or vehicles if need be, and breaching and breaking if we were involved in a building collapse of steel and concrete material. And we're going to go over and show you some of the different tools today and the equipment that we use to get those tasks completed. So, beginning at the front of the truck, in the tool compartment, this compartment is mainly designed and laid out for stabilization of a partially collapsed or significantly collapsed building. In this, we carry a complement of Paratex shoring, which these would actually, when they're all built and put into place, become members of the building to hold up whatever may be at fault or damaged in an event of any structural collapse. Down here are more pieces to that same equipment. These would actually attach to those. We could nail lumber to this to add additional shoring if needed. These are would be a temporary type shoring system. Say in the event of a tornado that we had a neighborhood damaged and we were searching several houses, we can put these together, get them on the house, get in, search a house, do what we need to do in there, get out, and move these right next door in a super timely manner versus building the wood shoring, which we are capable of doing also. If we go into a wood shoring, it's gonna be a longer, more drawn out event. So this is a just kind of a quick, fast, and in a hurry, get us in, get you out, and move down the road and keep going. The top here is gonna be some more of the same. Saw horses for, again, for building the wood shoring that we talked about. There's lighting here. We carry lighting all over the truck. You can see by looking around the truck as well that there's lights on the truck. If we can get it close enough to the scene, we can utilize those lights. Extension cords galore. We have a lot of 120 volt AC equipment on this truck. We do have a generator on here that is portable. We can move wherever we need to. We can reach it with as many extension cords as need be. So that would operate a lot of our tools, which are going to be stored in this compartment. And as you can see, the world is coming to cordless tools, battery powered tools. We've got a full complement of batteries. We've got charger banks in the cab of the truck that keep all those batteries charged. They stay ready to go. They're checked off every day. Everything on this truck is ready to go at any minute of any day. But again, the power tools, saws for cutting metal, drills for drilling whatever material may need, more demolition type reciprocating saws. We've got pneumatic tools. That would be a nailer for building the wood shores that I discussed a little bit a few minutes ago. We do carry the nails, a chop saw, again, to help us cut the lumber to build these wood shores that I was discussing. This is just kind of an everyday, everybody type toolbox. You never know, again, what we may have to fix some of our own things. We may need to remove panels from a building that are bolted on this. So that's just basically a every tool wood shop or workshop rather toolbox. In this compartment, we've got a complement of lumber that would be used primarily in a trench collapse situation. These are plywood panels that would be attached to a 2x12, and then they would be lowered into a trench with a system of ropes around a patient that may be trapped in the bottom of that trench. We carry shovels and things on top of this. We'll go through here in a little bit. So this vehicle would also be called to any kind of subterranean or trench collapse, which, as y'all know, with construction going on, could happen any minute. We hope it never does, but we're trying to be as prepared we can for whatever outside the normal day might happen. We do carry air bottles on both sides of the truck. These are our breathing air bottles, but on this particular apparatus, they're used to run our pneumatic tools. We do carry an air compressor and the things we would need for that. But in a situation that we needed to move inside of a collapsed building, taking an air compressor and things like that might not be the easiest, simplest way to do things. We can run our tools off of our breathing air bottles. Moving back, this is some more shoring, much like we looked at in that front compartment. This would be more for heavy vehicle stabilization and moving. and also for trench shoring, as we talked about with the panels from the previous compartment. Different tips and different tools on these for, again, shoring a cement mixer, an 18-wheeler, a big piece of construction equipment, whatever we might need to do. Behind are some more adapters and fittings for this same equipment. These three units here are hydraulic struts that are powered by a hydraulic pump. So when we do build this system, if we needed to lift or move the piece of equipment or the heavy truck or the concrete wall, whatever it might be, we do have the ability to lift a considerable amount of weight. These things, in built right, will lift about 80,000 pounds a piece. So we do have the capability of moving some pretty heavy stuff. Inside this compartment, here's a gasoline-powered air compressor I spoke about earlier. We'll get to the other side of the truck. There's an electric air compressor on the other side. Jackhammers with a whole assortment of bits for concrete breaching that we may need. These were actually used about 3 weeks ago. We had a mutual aid call outside of the city of Franklin where a child got his hand stuck in a piece of swimming pool equipment, and they actually had to go in and chisel up the concrete deck of that swimming pool. This equipment is similar, or what they would have used to have completed that task. We do have oxygen acetylene cutting equipment for steel breaching breaking. So this cabinet here, we can kind of get through some concrete stuff and some steel stuff. We've got some more tools to complement these as we go around the vehicle, and we'll talk about those here shortly. In these compartments here, we carry what is known in the fire service as a picket. It's much like a tent stake, but for some of our shoring equipment here, if we needed to stake some of these to the ground, we can drive these through. These pads up here have holes in them that are designed for this to drive through. We've got drills on the other side of the truck we'll talk about that we can drill the concrete and drive these down, and this will actually secure all of our shoring equipment to the earth itself. Moving around the back of the truck, we've got some small compartments here. We utilize the space under the steps for some more storage. These are grade 70 lifting chains that if we had to have a big wrecker or a crane to come in and help us move anything, we've got the capability with these big heavy chains. There are also some lifting straps. So we do train regularly, knowing which chains or straps we need to use for the loads that we have to secure or to move. Everything is rated, has its own purpose. So everything is tagged as to what kind of loads it will carry. You know, most all of the firefighters that are involved in the technical rescue program here have all of that built into their heads. They know whether or not they're going to need a chain or a strap, or how big a strap or how long a strap, things as that. But it's just another option for us if we do have to secure or move something that's very large and heavy. So moving around, if we do have to move a very heavy load, we do have to secure it once we get it up. We will not leave our lifting equipment under that. So we will build a crib system, and this compartment is that material that we would use to build those crib systems, where we would actually stack these blocks. Every time we lift a load, we'll build blocks underneath it. So if something catastrophic happened in the middle and it did fall, it would not fall any further than the crib stacks that we've built under it as we're raising it. Some more straps. Again, this would be for heavy tow truck operations or crane operations. If we needed to move a big air conditioning unit off of a roof or something as that matter. These are lighter straps than we talked about in the back, but again, everything has its purpose. Air hoses are up here. We carry a large complement of pneumatic tools. So just like the extension cords, We make sure that we have plenty of air hose. Talk to you about so this air compressor is the same one we saw from the other side of the truck. Over here we have just an air tank, and then this would be our air cart that those bottles, our breathing air bottles, would actually fit into this cart. And we've got a manifold here that we can run just like we're running off of an air compressor without making fumes or any other hazards that if we're in a confined space or a closed environment. Down here are some more of the big chains that we would use again, secure or move very heavy loads. This would be more or less involved in a crane operation. Again, more air bottles. We'd carry a total of 6. And then every apparatus in the city has plenty more. So we do also have an air truck that would complement this truck. If we needed more air, they will bring whatever we need. So this is just the other side of the plywood and the 2x12s that we talked about earlier. We can unload that from either side of the rig as needed. Moving forward, down here, these are come-alongs that we would use with those chains. If we needed to move a load horizontally, we could find an anchor point that would be substantial enough to lock one side of this to. We can use the chains or the straps that we had in the back and actually rig the load and use the come-along. It works as a ratchet, and it will actually wind the chain through its gears, and we can actually move a load horizontally if need be that way. This compartment complements our steel and concrete cutting compartment on the other side with K-12 saws, as they're known in the fire service. Demolition saws, some call them. These are set up to cut concrete or metal. This one's actually set up with a blade on it to cut metal if we needed to cut through a garage door. This one would cut reinforced concrete. It'll cut through the concrete or the steel up to roughly 5 inches thick. If we need to cut any deeper than that, which a lot of times in structural concrete we would, we train regularly on techniques on how to step cut or how to get down deeper into a piece of concrete with this same tool. We carry concrete drills, all kind of bits for those drills should we need to attach lifting eyes to a piece of concrete to move it out of our way, we can do that. We do also carry a search camera on the truck that if we had somebody missing in a building and had an idea that they might be in a confined spot, this would be known as a core drill bit, and it will drill a hole big enough that we can get the head of our camera after we core that out. We can get the head of a camera into that void space. Those cameras have they not only have camera on them, but they do also have audio on them that we can talk through them to somebody on the other side, or they can talk back to us. So again, very useful tool in a building collapse incident. We have rebar cutters, 2 different style rebar cutters. This one actually works as a zip saw. It's built much like a 4-inch grinder, but it actually saws rebar, or it will saw wrought iron fence, whatever we might need to get through. And then we have a shear on this side. It's considerably heavier, but it will shear material quite a bit bigger than the saw will. So again, it's a redundancy. It's something else we have that there seems to be always, when you get into this, there's always something bigger that we've got to get through. So we try to look ahead and keep the equipment that we need for whatever we can imagine might ever happen. We learn a lot of that from what goes on in the world. We learn it from our own experiences here. So we're all the time adding tools to this truck when we see something that might help us help y'all. There are little pockets also, if you look this way. We carry saw blades, chainsaw chains, grinding discs, again, sawzall blades, drill bits. It's just a rolling hardware store, basically. Moving forward, this is kind of our lifting cabinet. We've got two 50-ton bottle jacks. We've got two 20-ton bottle jacks. In the event that we had to lift or secure, say again, a cement mixer, a dump truck, an 18-wheeler, a concrete slab in a collapsed building, there are many, many uses for the jacks. We've got automotive jacks. We've had events where people were stuck under vehicles, and that's the fastest way to get them back up is to use these automotive jacks. Up top here, we've got a full complement of airbags. These are high-pressure airbags. They will actually stack those under a load and then inflate them with air, and they'll lift the load to whatever height we need, depending on how many bags we've used and what sort of foundation we've built to put those on. A lot of technical training goes into the equipment on this truck, and myself and Battalion Chief Pardue have gone through a collapse specialist program at Texas A&M University, and it was over 500 hours of just using equipment like this in a collapse scenario, in a building collapse scenario. It did involve vehicles trapped in parking garages. It involved us rappelling off of a roof and sawing through the side of a building and the concrete to get into a building from floors above. It was a really good eye-opening, and a lot of the tools and the things that are on this truck came back from that class, the ideas for that. So this would be the back seat of the apparatus. As you can tell, there are two fixed seats, and then on the back wall there are four what we call jump seats. Again, this particular apparatus would be a call as needed, and would not necessarily, unless we were going to an event in a local community around us, be transporting a lot of firefighters. If it operated in the city limits, it would meet other companies that are already staffed, and they would get their manpower from it. We'll move up top. We've got a few more things. Moving all the way forward here, this would be our power unit, our generator unit. Obviously, it's too much for us to handle to set off the side of the truck. So we have an integrated crane system built into the truck that will deploy, and it will handle this gen set, any of these heavy tools up here. It'll set them off to the side, lower them down, and likewise, it'll pick them back up and put them right back up here as we're finished with them. This compartment here is dewatering. If we had a situation where we had people in a basement that was flooding or whatever may be that we needed to move water, we've got a 2-inch trash pump. We've got water hose for any of our concrete cutting equipment down there. Obviously, when we saw concrete or chip concrete, we make a lot of dust. We don't want to create an environment that somebody can't breathe in, so we'll use water off of one of the other fire apparatus that would be there to help control that dust. If that water got to be too much, then we do have means of dewatering that as well. This compartment over here is again set up for shoring. It's some prefab pieces of shoring that we would build on site, wood shoring, wedges and plates that we would use in a lot of the wrecker shores and the things that we use to stabilize collapsed buildings. Moving back, we've got some prying equipment, bars to pinch concrete, move pieces of concrete, steel, whatever you need to do. There's some shovels and things in the very back here. They would be used primarily for trench or, well, honestly, anything that we needed to move dirt with. Over here, we have safety equipment for our chainsaws. There are chaps and helmets with ear protection and eye protection in the orange boxes. I'll grab one out. They're just pre-put together boxes. If we got again into having to build wooden shores, a firefighter could grab a box that has the basic tools already in it that he's going to need, he or she would need, to start building shores for stabilizing a building or a vehicle, whatever it may be. Obviously, they'll be more involved than this, but this is just a good start pack. Rescue helmets. A lot of times in confined space, our fire helmets with the big brims and all just aren't suited for the environment we may be in. So these helmets are all, they're all fire department rescue helmets. There are lights in this bag here that mount to those helmets. They mount on a bracket right here should it be a nighttime or they're going into a dark environment. So in a nutshell, that's kind of what we keep on our technical rescue truck as it goes out the door. There are several other trucks in the city that complement this that have some similar equipment. There are some that have some more equipment. This one is, again, designed mainly for stabilization, for shoring of heavy, large objects, vehicles, or buildings. It's designed for lifting and moving heavy, large objects, or breaching and breaking concrete and steel to get through a building searching for possible victims.